Welcome everybody, and thanks a lot for the invitation. My topic is digital transformation as a matter of values, and I listened to the presentations before, and I think there are a lot of connections on the one hand to the projects we've been presented in the 2 hours after lunch. At the same time, I'm coming from a somewhat different direction because I'm not coming from technology, and I'm also not coming from the artistic and aesthetic side, but really from the context of arts management. So what I'm going to try to do is offer a kind of provocation at the end of the conference in 3 steps, looking first at what I would like to call the birth defect of the field of arts management, and then a few words about digital transformation in a broader social sense and arts management's reaction or agency in that, and then I'll end exactly on that note of what could we, for example, do in the context of digital transformation in the field of arts management if we imagined ways of being more open with our data and sharing our data amongst each other. I'll be starting with the first look at the field of arts management, and I just want to say one word in general for the whole presentation. This is not all purely research-based. Some is more like a reaction to experiences I also had in organizational development projects. Some of it is also a bit exaggerated, I guess, and I somewhat fear that I'll be preaching to the converted, that many of you will agree on what I say more or less, and there are other people who probably I would like to listen to this who would be more contradicting, but we'll see about that in the end. Maybe I'm wrong about that. So let's first look at arts management and what I call the birth defect of arts management. If you look at arts management not as a practice, which obviously has been around for like centuries, you could argue, but as a field of professional research and professional training at universities in other kind of training programs, you can more or less say it's 30 years now. The first programs have been started in the German language context in Vienna, in Hamburg. European level, you have Barcelona, which is 30 years old. Belgrade is a very old program. So something happened around 1987 that in different locations, arts management as a professional field with professional training programs popped up. And if we look at what's happened there, this birth moment and what I would like to call the birth defect of that moment, is that something was called arts management or Kulturmanagement in the German region, which actually had a very clear one-way direction. And it's this direction that the emphasis in a way was on management, and the arrow, the vector, you could say, goes from management towards the arts. And the thinking or the reasoning behind this, in a way, was a gesture, and here I know I'm being unfair and exaggerating, but in an exaggerated way, you could say the gesture was, let's clean up the mess that you find in arts organizations. They're doing everything just how they feel they should do it. It's all a bit improvised. And we've got so many tools and methods from the business world, let's bring those to the arts. That, I would say, is the founding moment and the founding gesture of most of arts management programs that you find. So we have the arts at that moment thought mainly as big organizations, high culture, so theaters, museums, and orchestras, which were supposed to be more professional in their administration by using business tools and models. You could also say business school tools and models. I would say that's like the birth moment of most of arts management programs. And of course, what happened there, in a way, you could call a process of translation. You take models and tools that have been developed in different contexts, in the business context, and you applied them to the field of the arts. And these processes of translation are never simple and they're never trivial. And there hasn't been a lot of research, and I would love to see some research being done on the history of the field and on the history of the discourse of arts management in those founding moments. But there is some literature in general. What are challenges if you translate business management context to other social spheres with other logics? And if we just like look at 3 main challenges. One would be that very often, if you take business models and bring them into other social fields, you have an oversimplification of concepts. So what we teach our arts management students, very often business students would say, like, but it's more complex than you teach it. And actually, we are like a step further than what you're teaching right now. So very often it's outdated concepts. The moment something arrives in arts management, the business people already have the next tools and methods coming and using them. And very often also these different logics coming from a purely business for-profit context to this artistic, aesthetic, very often not-for-profit logics are not adequately reflected. There's one book I can recommend to anybody interested in these processes. It's not about arts management, it's about research management. But Robert Birnbaum, who all his life more or less spent as a research manager and a manager in higher education, wrote a great book about management fads in higher education, where they come from, what they do and why they fail. And I think you can read that story and more or less apply his reasoning also to the arts management context. So by translating somewhat uncritically business management models to the arts, I think we imported a number of concepts unwittingly and certainly uncritically. For example, ideas like the customer. Ideas like the market, and if we talk about marketing, we've got that very word there, and the question is, what idea of a market actually do we have? Do we ever reflect on the implications of that term? And also concepts like competition, which are at the basis of business management, and there's nothing inherently bad about competition, but the question is this the mode in which we want to think about how we run our arts organizations? And competition also very often implies win-lose constellations. So we try to teach USP strategies, we try to teach ways to, for example, compete about the attention of our potential audiences. And all this is very well, and I'm not arguing that we don't need business knowledge and we don't need certain kinds of skills, but I think we probably should have been all along, and certainly we're at the point where we need to be more critical and not just like import these things without rethinking them. So my first idea is that 30 years after this birth moment of arts management as a professional field, it's time to reflect, rethink, and maybe redo our idea of arts management. And I'm going to quote one question that was asked in January. We hosted our institution, the annual conference for arts management on the topic of cultural leadership. We had a number of great keynotes. We had one keynote from Amelie Deufelhardt, who's the artistic director of Kampnagel in Hamburg. And she told the stories of her time in Berlin after the wall fell and how naive everybody was and how just hands-on people took advantage of like unused spaces and created things. And if you look at the list of names, arts managers just as well as artists, who worked in Berlin in this time, it's more or less today's who is who of German big name artists, global artists. So one question was, is there any space left for this naivety and this unprofessional way of doing arts after 3 decades now that we train professionally how arts management should be done, how arts organizations should be run, which models should be implemented? And Stephen Walter, who maybe is a familiar name in this region, the founder of the Podium Festival, probably like the contemporary classical music festival in Europe right now, asked a question to Amelie Deufelhardt, and he said, where's the space for rock and roll in arts management? Is there any leeway left after this process of professionalization? And I think that's a very important general question that we need to ask. If we focus a bit more on my topic of today, I would say it's about balancing the relationship of the two words, arts and management. And if you want to follow these lyrics by Jarvis Cocker, who said every relationship is a two-way street, then the question is, how do these two arts and management contexts, how do they meet? What's the relation? Is it really a two-way street? I think it's been a one-way street in the past, or it's been a two-way street in the way that Jarvis Cocker describes it here, with somebody being the driver and the other one having more or less fun, probably, in the back of the car. So what does this mean for the future of arts management? I think we need to change this idea that arts management means bringing business management professionality to the arts into a more balanced relationship. And that would mean that we should, after 30 years, be in the position to say arts management is a field of practice in its own right with its own self-confidence. And for me, that, for example, can imply that where business management has to offer certain core terms and concepts, we should at least reflect where we want to import them and whether, for example, The customer for us is not as important as communities. The market for us is not as important as the commons or the public sphere. Competition is not as important to us as collaboration might be. And win-lose constellations are not as important to us as win-win constellations might be. And I know, again, I'm being unfair to many organizations, because of course these are conversations that we're having and we've been having for quite a while, but I think we're not having them often enough and not in all kinds of organizations. So that's one thing I would hope to see changing in the future. And it also means for me that our understanding of arts, when we teach arts management, when we reflect on the practice of arts management, should not just include high culture, big institutions, but also smaller scale institutions, projects, creative industries, and many more. And by doing that, to come to a point when actually we not only take inspiration from other fields, and those other fields shouldn't be just business, but for example, also higher education, non-profit sectors, but also to contribute. If we say we're a practice with self-confidence, it could also mean that we develop our own way of managing organizations, of managing projects, and being able to offer these to others than just to import concepts from elsewhere. So that's my first very general statement about the history of arts management, and you'll see me coming back to this, so it's not disconnected from my further line of argument. The second context, the second provocation I would like to make, and I'm being very oversimplifying in the next step, is a thought about digital transformation and arts management. Somewhat tongue-in-cheek, I'm presenting you three steps of digital transformation so far. The first step was nobody noticed. The second step were tech utopias. And I'm not talking about arts management, I'm talking like about the more broader conversation about digital transformation. You had this idea of openness, democratization, sharing cultures, Twitter bringing revolution to the Arab world, like an idea of moving forward to some better shared future globally. And of course, we had like pessimistic perspectives at that time too. But I think there was a moment when many people were convinced there is this potential for like a utopian step forward connected to digital transformation. And if you look at the atmosphere, at least in Western countries right now, it seems that dystopia won. I think that's stage three we're in right now. We've got these huge commercial BMOs. We've got Google, Facebook, Apple. And they somehow took over. And when we talk about openness or sharing or connecting, we're thinking about connecting on commercial platforms, Facebook and so on, not so much about like this utopian agency connected idea of digital transformation. So if this is a very overgeneralized tongue-in-cheek presentation of digital transformation in general, then what has been the history of digital transformation in arts management? I think we're on the same line in the first step. First, nobody really cared and nobody really noticed. To me, the second step was, do we need to be on Second Life? That was a discussion you had some time ago, but I guess some of you remember that moment. This idea, oh, there's something happening there and we need to be part of it. We have to be on whichever platform is current and fashionable right now. I think we moved on somewhat, and my somewhat ironic third moment is, do we need to be on Snapchat? I think in many arts organizations, the conversation hasn't really changed. We're still talking about platforms, tools, channels, and reflecting on, is this something we need to do? But I'm quite convinced that this is not the way arts management should deal with digital transformation, just looking like, what is the next train we need to jump on, but have a much more fundamental look at digital transformation. And I want to illustrate that by a quote from a philosopher, I think, who's very well known, at least in the ZKM too, Willem Flusser, who wrote a text back in 1978, so long before we talked about digital transformation, about media history. And he made it like huge, on 7 pages, a huge story about 2,000 years of media history. And he wrote about the electronic codes of his time. So when he talks about digital techno codes, he means photography, film, television, video. And he says our ignorance regarding these new codes of his time is not surprising. It took writers, when script was invented, centuries after the invention of script to learn that writing means narrating. And it's going to take just as long until we learn the virtualities of the techno codes, until we learn what photography, film, video, or writing analog programs, today you could add digital programs, digital technology, actually mean. So to put it in short, what Flusser is telling us, we're in a process of as fundamental a transformation as the invention of script has been for human society and human culture, and we don't have a clue where we're going. And I think that's a very helpful reminder in everything that we do, that if we follow this, we could borrow a term that Dirk Becker has familiarized in Germany, actually is coming from Peter Drucker from the US, we might be on our way to something like the next society, a society that we don't really know and understand yet, but we already feel that there's something very fundamental changing. So we see we don't have the words and the tools and the models to describe it, and we're still in the process, but there is something happening which is more radical than just like a new channel of communication. And if this is the case, and I very strongly think that's a framing that convinces me, I have a very interesting or very like poignant quote to share. George Westerman, in an article for the MIT Sloan Report, said, "When it comes to digital transformation, digital is not the answer. Transformation is." And I think that's the perspective I see lacking in arts management. We talk a lot about technology, we talk a lot about the latest tools that we can use. We don't really reflect on the term transformation. Where is it that we're actually headed? And if that's the case now, that we're on our way to the next society, the first question to ask is not whether to be on Instagram. It is what kind of world we want to live in and what our role as arts organizations should be in that world. So it's taking a step back from the frenzy and the energy of the moment of whatever is our attention goes to at that point technologically and ask more fundamental questions. And I'm taking my cues now from very traditional and simple questions from organizational development, you could say. What is our purpose? What are our values? Who are or who should be our stakeholders? Who should be our communities? How do we see our role as an arts organization in this huge social and cultural transformation? If we could start today from scratch, what would we do differently? Based on our past experiences, what do we want to keep? What do we want to preserve? It's not all about transformation. It's always also about balancing change and stability. And finally, what would it mean to be successful? I think if we have an answer to that question, and like a complex and rich answer, we would be a lot of many steps further. I don't think it's success to have X followers on Instagram. Success for an arts organization will be something going deeper than that. And that conversation, I feel, very often is lacking. So in that context, digital transformation is not an issue for the marketing department alone or for the technical operations alone. In that context, the place for digital transformation in arts organizations should be at the core of what you could call strategy, organizational development, or a term I personally quite like in a certain reading, cultural leadership. So that's my second point. I think there is a problem we have with arts management in general. I think there's a problem we have with the way digital transformation is handled in many arts organizations. And I want to give one example to conclude how a different approach maybe could look like with really just one exemplary case. Imagine a museum answering these questions. I'm not going to go through it, but just for a moment think about what could be answers if you really took time with a team, maybe including your stakeholders, your communities around you, and really going through those questions. Would you be doing what you're doing right now? Or would that change something? One question I would like to focus on now is, for example, if we talk, what are our values? Do we want to follow values of competition and win-lose? Maybe that's the values our head of the cultural policy office of our city, of our community, municipality would like us to go for, but then on the other hand, they're financing two museums. Do they really want them to compete? Maybe not even them. Or do we want to go for collaboration and do we want to look more for win-win constellations? I think that's a road that's not traveled often enough to really say one of our values is collaboration and we're looking for that. I was really delighted, for example, to hear the presentation by the Museum of Digital Art said, for us, collaboration is at the heart of what we do. I think that's a great example of a real-life organization. I'm going to take one very managerial example. What could change? If you look at ticket sales, big data in arts organizations, at least in the German language context, what kind of knowledge do arts organizations generate through their ticket sales? I guess everybody of you has been asked one question in the past when you bought a ticket in a museum: may I ask for your postcode, please? That's more or less as differentiated as most organizations go. Whereas we would have the potential with online sales and so on to get much more complex data. So imagine for a moment what you could do as an arts organization by systematically using the data you already have or could very easily gather. You could do targeted marketing, communication, audience development, in terms, for example, of topics, but also in terms of timing. There are some organizations, particularly in the Anglo-American and Scandinavian and Netherlands, who already have a very good way of knowing when certain audiences book their tickets for events, for exhibitions, and really addressing them at the moment when they would be at the point where they want to buy. So some might be very last minutes, others would be very long time ahead. You could know that, and you could do customized communication with your audiences. You could have much better sales predictions and utilization predictions for your programs. You could have something like dynamic pricing if you want to go that route. So there's many, many potentialities only if you use your own data more thoroughly than most organizations do at this point. Now imagine what arts organizations could do if they share their data with each other. And I'm very glad that I heard that that already was a topic also on the panel where Björn Bonenkamp was, this idea of if we want to have a segmented marketing and if we're not just looking at our audience but the whole audience that's interested in the arts in a region or in a town or in a county, there's so much more you could do. And I'm just going to spell out a few thoughts. If you look at it internally for organizations, you would know audiences and non-audiences much better because you know there's people who are interested in the arts, maybe even interested in something that you're also doing, but they never came to you, they came to partner organizations. And you could know about them. You could have improved individualized communication. You could do cross-marketing and collaboration much more efficiently. You have the potential to develop a post-subscription era marketing system. I'm going to say a word about that to conclude. And you have the chance of constant comparison, sharing of experiences, best practices. You know what worked in another partner organization. So internally, you gain much more knowledge and information. But if you take the community perspective, it's also, I think, a real positive development. You get customized information. You get alerts for things that really interest you from different organizations. You don't have to subscribe to 20 or 30 newsletters in a region like Karlsruhe, Mannheim, Heidelberg, Ludwigshafen, or in a town like Hamburg or Berlin, and then have all that clutter that you actually can't really deal with, but you would have that centralized, customized way. So decluttering your search for information, potentially creating flexible pricing, maybe even flat rate capped cost models, reducing your spending on individual visits because your visits in various organizations could be counted together, and many more. And when I talk about these ideas, the first thing that usually gets raised is this question, yeah, but what about privacy? And I think that's a valuable and important concern. We shouldn't ignore that concern. But I think we should also think about what's the alternative to this. Right now, our alternative is not no privacy issues, but actually companies like Ticketmaster, Eventim, dealing with a lot of this data and using it for commercial purposes. So it's not that customers aren't already sharing this data with credit card and everything. They're sharing it to commercial companies. And most arts organizations don't get that feedback loop that they have the information that these companies have if you go in a partnership with these. So if we say there was something lost in the history of digital transformation, this idea of sharing, of democratization, has been lost to commercial companies, I think that's partly to the fault that we're not collaborating on this open, non-profit, democratic level or civil society level, you could say. So just to present one concrete idea, and it's actually an idea that came up in a conversation with Björn Bonenkamp, Dominika Schoppe, as we prepared thoughts for this conference, imagine an app or a platform which suggests curated, individually curated, personal from people from the organizations, but also algorithm-based suggestions based on personal interests from various institutions in a region. Imagine even a capped cost pricing model, which guarantees that I do not spend more than the sum of X euros per month or per season, no matter how much I visit these institutions. This could be something like a subscription turned around. You don't have to say in the first place I'm paying so many euros for 20 performances, but if I go to more than 20, I don't pay anymore. That could be something easily implemented and provided by a non-profit network of the institutions themselves, where I'm quite sure that privacy concerns of the users of the communities would be much less than to share their data with Eventim and Ticketmaster and so on. So imagine what we could do based on collaboration instead of competition as a key concept of arts management. Looking for win-win instead of looking for win-lose or avoiding contact altogether, not thinking about it as win-lose, but more as we do our own thing and we don't talk about that. If we could work on self-confidence and mutual trust instead of insecurity and fear, and very often these are actually the drivers that keep people from collaborating, what happens if they see that we don't sell as many tickets as everybody thinks we do? What happens if they see that all our customers actually come from one specific community in our town? So this idea that we cannot make that visible is something that keeps us from collaborating. Imagine what we could do if we were acting based on curiosity, openness, experimentation, all, I think, modes of thinking and working that are fostered in a digital context potentially, but instead so many institutions still are playing it safe, and that of course means they're doing what they have been doing all along for decades in many contexts. These were my three steps, and just to summarize, and then I'm at the end of this. I think arts management should not be a derivative of business management, but strive to become a self-confident practice in its own right, stressing the words arts and management equally. Digital transformation in this context would be a fundamental challenge for the whole organization and calls for reflection or reflecting on strategy, organizational development, and cultural leadership first before moving into operations context. And finally, arts organizations, I don't think, will be able to do this alone in terms of resources needed and everything, but they have a huge potential for doing this in collaborations, and sharing data could be one possible starting point. That's what I wanted to share. Thank you very much, and I'm looking forward to the final discussion.